Good morning, my brothers and sisters in Facebook all over the world. Amen. God bless you this morning. We are here, hallelujah time here at the Corinth Church. We thank God in Temple, Texas, 321 South 10th Street here in the heart of Temple, Texas. We are just, hallelujah, glad, hallelujah, sanctified, and hallelujah, filled with the Spirit. We're just happy this morning. Amen, that you are with us and sharing, amen, here in our ministry. God bless you and God keep you is our prayer. Thank God we are still on this side of heaven. Amen, amen, amen. I ain't gonna be like some folks. I'm ready to go. I'm getting ready to go. Amen. I know I got to go, but I haven't put any applications in yet. Amen, amen. But I know God is good, and I know God is always able. And I had three fellas say, if he don't do it, it ain't because he can't do it. Amen. God bless you. God bless you and keep you this Sunday morning. I want to tell the Hirsch family, Melvin Hirsch family in Houston, Texas. Amen. Melvin Hirsch and Sister Zola, Charlene, Stephanie, and grandchildren, amen, that we are praying with you and for you. My good friend, one of my close friends, brother, amen, have transitioned and gone home to the Lord. Amen. God has called him home. Amen. God bless him and God bless the family. Amen. We're praying the Corinth Church is praying with you. He was a friend of the Corinth family. Amen. And a friend and a brother and president of the Lincoln District Congress. Amen. Association. The Lincoln District Congress Association. Amen. Certainly he will be missed. One of his famous words. That's enough. That's enough. Amen. God bless you and God keep you is our prayer. I want to share with you also this morning, amen, while I was here in the office, got a call from Nashville, Tennessee. Sister Minnie Dixon. Sister Minnie Dixon is asking you for prayer. I'm asking you to pray for her. Wherever you are, pray for her. Amen. Charlie Dixon, the Virgin Dixon's daughter, amen, is loving the Lord, loving the Lord. And praising God. She asked for prayer for her two children. Amen. And certainly we'll be doing that. I want to share with you on next Sunday morning, we will share the Lord's Supper. Amen. I didn't have it this Sunday morning, but next Sunday morning, we will be sharing the Lord's Supper. How are we going to do it? Good question. All right. Saturday between 11 o'clock and 1 o'clock. Amen. I believe it's 11 to 1 or 10 to 1, one of the two. Amen. We're asking all of the Corinth family, amen, that want to participate in communion, the Lord's Supper, to come by on Saturday, pick up the package we have for you. And right after the sermon, Sunday morning on Facebook, I will administer the Lord's Supper to all of us, amen. We're not going to leave out, amen, remembering that God got up from the grave. We're not going to do it, amen. We're going to have the Lord's Supper, amen. Go ask you to come Saturday, drive by, amen. Our deaconess will be out to bring it to the car. You don't even have to get out. You wear your gloves if you want to. It'll be in a plastic bag, and we'll be giving it to you, amen, Saturday morning. I'm going to say from 11 to 1 or 10 to 1, one of the two, but you will know. God bless you. God keep you. I want to say happy 4th of July weekend to all of you. Pray that you had a marvelous and a glorious time this week. Amen. Didn't get in any trouble. You're still lifting up the name Jesus. I don't know about you this morning, but I'm glad to be here on this side of earth. It may not be the best America I live in. It may not be the best to go on in America. Do we have problems in America? Yes, but I'm glad to be an American. Amen, amen, amen. I'm glad to be on this side in America. I was born in America. I paid my light bill in America. You ain't listening to me. I was educated in America. And I love America. Amen. Amen. I'm not saying everything is perfect. I'm just saying I love America. I don't want to be nowhere else but in America. God bless you. And God, that's just me. I don't know about you. I'm not angry with you. You think like you want to. This is me. Amen, amen. God saved me in America, and that's where I want to be, in America. Amen, amen. Noah's prophet said, yes, it stinks inside of the ship. I don't like the stench that's in here, but I'd rather be on the inside of the ship than to be on the outside. Are you listening to me? If you're on the inside, you got some safety. Amen. God bless you and God keep you as I pray. I want to talk with you this morning from a familiar scripture, a very familiar scripture I want to share with you, coming from Isaiah, the 40th chapter, the 29th verse. I believe that's where I'm going. The 29th verse. And the Bible says, in the King James Version, KJV, it says, he giveth power to the faint. And to them that have no might, he increaseth strength. Are you listening to me? And 40 and 29 says, he give power to the weak, of the NLT. He give power to the weak and strength to the powerless. What a marvelous thing this morning, amen, to know. And I want to talk to you this morning. There's hope in the midst of despair. Amen. There's hope in the midst of despair. This book was written, amen, the prophet Isaiah, amen, the prophet Isaiah. I noticed something. Eagles are very powerful birds of prey. Yes, they are powerful birds of prey. You know what prey is? It's an animal that hunts and kills another. Are you listening? Eagles are powerful birds at prey and have extremely keen eyesight that allows them to see clearly a great distance away. They fly so high until you lose them in the sun, but their eyes are keen. And they can see a long distance away. Are you listening? Their wings stretch 9 feet apart, flat. They are strong and swift birds that are able to see in a long distance. The prophet Isaiah is often called an eagle eye. Often, I wondered why. It's because Isaiah span great distance between times. He could see things from a distance that nobody else was able to see. He ministered He ran during the time he ministered during the time of King Uzziah, Jonathan, Ahaz, and Hezekiah. Another thing about Isaiah is also called the Messianic prophet because he was able to see down through time. He was able to see the coming of the Messiah. I'm talking about Isaiah. But then he was a child of the king. King Hezekiah, who had been ill, was visited by a group from Babylon. They were sent to bestow upon him gifts and best wishes for recovery. Hezekiah took the group after getting better on a tour of his palace and his kingdom. I want you to catch that. Hezekiah took a tour of the palace, his palace, and his kingdom. Even showing them the treasures in the storehouse. Isaiah, being a man of God, informed the king that the Lord said there will come a time. If the church was here with me, I would say there will come a time when Babylon would seize all of Hezekiah's treasure and take some of his descendants into captivity. This, of course, my brothers and sisters, would not be the fate of the king's family only. Isn't it amazing? Seemed like to me he would just deal with King Hezekiah's family. But he dealt with all of Judea. God warned them because Judah was guilty of idol worship. Something tells me that God is a jealous God. They worship idol gods. God warned the people. Can I tell you? He warned the people through his prophet that a period of exile awaited all of them, and that destruction of the land and the temple was on the way. I think I ought to let you know God will give you some warnings. I think I ought to let you know that God will give you warnings. Warnings every Sunday morning. Preachers are preaching. YouTube is full of preachers preaching. Even in this situation we're in, God is warning. Are you listening? But God promised that he would still be a source of hope for his people. And I like that because when I look at it, it lets me know that God will not give up on me. Although I may be worshiping the idol gods, and I may be doing things that I should not be doing, God still is the source of hope to us today. The Bible said to his people. The verse begins in number 1, verse 1 and 40 says, comfort ye, comfort ye. I was sitting in the office and fellowshipping with two of my preachers, and one of them said to the other, in a situation that we're in now, the people are not able to come to church. They are not allowed to come no more than 10 gathering because of the situation that we're in. One said to the other, folks are getting discouraged. Folks have a hung down head. Folks are dissatisfied. But one said to the other, what the folks need now is comfort. And I said, thank you, Lord. Comfort ye. Comfort ye. Who was he talking to? He was talking to the Jews approximately 100 years after Isaiah's death. Now Isaiah prophesied 100 years or so before it even come to pass. God will send somebody. God will sell somebody. God will tell you and shake you and mold you and get your attention to let you know it will come to pass. Yes, yes. So Isaiah said, when it does come, I may be dead and gone. Comfort ye. Comfort ye. He was talking to the Jews approximately 100 years after Isaiah's death. We find themselves living in exile in Babylonian. Babylon, to understand that in the past when you take them from your homeland. If it were black history, I really could deal with this. Isn't it bad when you're taken from your roots and put somewhere else to change your culture and to change who you really are? Isn't it dangerous? But as Israel was in exile in Babylonia. Now, to understand why they needed comfort. Why would they need comfort? To understand Judah, the city of Jerusalem, the temple of Jerusalem. It meant something special to Israel. It meant something special to the Israelites. Jerusalem was the city God chose for himself. I think you ought to get happy when God chooses the city for himself. What makes that city so great? It's because God, number one, chooses it. Number two, it says something about that city. It says that God will protect the city that he has chosen. What else does it say? God will supply the city that he has chosen. What else does it say? God is the father of that city. Well, when I thought about it, I said, isn't it good to know when God chooses you as his child? Because what that really means is that God will protect you. The watch over you. That God will supply your every need. That God will go with you until the end of the world. Number two, the city that God chose. His spirit dwell in the city. Yes, yes. The temple was the center of Jewish belief system. And I look and I believe that the Christians today know that the church is the symbol of their belief system. I know we are in walls, and I know we are in pews, and I know we are in lights and all of that, and I understand that the church is within us, but I think it's a good thing when the saints of God can come together and worship together, because that is a symbol of our identity of who God really is. The Bible says, forget not the gathering of yourselves. I wish I had a church here. Of yourself. I know who I am. I know my identity in the Lord Jesus Christ. I know where God has brought me from. I know God has chosen for his people. God has put us together for a reason. Are you praying? And while the people of Judah was still in the midst of their sin, punishment was still pending. Isn't it only why they were still doing wrong? Why they were still worshiping idol gods? God had already set the stage for his deliverance. And even in your mess, even in your wrongdoing, even in your sin, God has already set the stage for our deliverance. Can I get a witness here? Already set the stage. Isn't it amazing? You doing wrong now, but the answer is over here. You out of pocket over here, but God got the solution over here. You can't change the situation, but God already has it in motion. Can I drop a dime here? Because of the pandemic going on today, because schools can't open, because you can't go in the restaurant, you ought not get upset up there, because God is already working it out right now. So I come to tell you this morning to be encouraged. Jeremiah 29:11 says, I know my plans I have for you. I know what plans I have for you, declares the Lord. This is God talking himself. Although you may be wrong, you may be in your situation, God already knows the plan he has for you. And he has for you. The Lord already knows the plan. Plan to prosper you. And plans not to harm you. Plan to give you hope in a dire, desperate situation. God already knows the plan. Well, don't you say, thank you, Lord, that you already know my situation. You already know my situation. You already know what condition I'm in. You already understand I need you right now. You already understand where I am in you. Can I get a witness here? But I heard the writer went on to say, Isaiah in this lesson in the book of Matthew Henry, the commentator said, Isaiah was referring to the prophet who will be living in captivity along with our fellow Jews. prophets would call for their people to prepare for God's deliverance. And I want to say to the world this morning, all we got to do is prepare for the Lord's deliverance, because deliverance is on the way. The Bible said, if my people, which are called by my name, would humble themselves and pray, God is already working it out. Can I get a witness here? So you don't have to fret, and you don't have to be scared. You don't have to be nervous, because if God said enough is enough, God is already working it out. Yes, Isaiah was saying that God had extended mercy. The recipients of that mercy need to become active in response. Yeah, if God has given you mercy this morning, you ought to tell the Lord, say, you ought to respond by saying, I led up the Lord, he heard my cry. If God has shown mercy, you see, we serve a merciful God. Can I get a witness here? The metaphor that God promised Isaiah, he said, make straight in a desert highway. Make straight in a desert highway. What is he really saying? The word straight means level, level, and become smooth. Make straight in a desert highway. I want you to make the road straight in a desert place. In a desert, have you ever seen a desert where there's no hope, where it seems like you're going to die in a desert? But the writer said, make straight in a desert place. What is it really saying to you and I this morning? We need to level out our lives. We need to make things smooth in our lives. We got too many potholes in the road. We got too many holes going down the road. We got too many humps and bumps in the road. And we need to make straight the highway this morning. We need to tell the Lord, straighten up our lives. Yeah, straighten up where anxiety has set in. Straighten up where nervousness has set in. Straighten up where fear have set in. Straighten up so I won't have to worry no more. I'm tired of being on the edge. It seems like when I'm on the edge, my Heavenly Father, it seems like I ain't gonna make it until tomorrow. So we need to straighten the highways of our life. Make the terrain even in our life. Make it so we can travel with no humps and bumps. Yes, we need to be right and upright. We need to live where God can use us in his service. For I heard the Bible say, comfort is an ongoing word of hope and comfort, which God is going to repeatedly speak to his people. God will not leave you alone. He called the prophet to speak comfortable. He says, speak to the heart of Jerusalem. There is a message in the message this morning. There is some hope here this morning. There is hope in the midst of despair. I don't care how bad it looks. I don't care how rough it looks. There is hope this morning. God has forgiven his people for their sin. And I said a few minutes ago, if my people would just go in your secret closet, if my people would go down on your knees, if my people would say, Father, I stretch my hand, if my people would say, our Father, which art in heaven, if my people, if God spoke, God have called us, yes, if God is calling morning. For the Bible says, in Proverbs 3:11 and 12, my son, do not despise the Lord's discipline and do not resent his rebuke, because the Lord disciplines those he loves. Can I get a witness here? His father let me discipline our son. God will do what he has to do to get your attention. God may have to send sickness to get your attention. God may have to send death to get your attention. God may have to call on us to get our attention. He has to shake us and move us, rock us to get our attention. But I come now to tell you, he may have to use excessive force, because some of us are hard-headed and we don't want to hear what the Lord is saying. But I come to tell you this morning, don't let the Lord use excessive force this morning. He's able to turn it around in your life. He's able to lift you up. He's able to pick you up. I come back and tell you that God has reached his turning point. I used to hear a song by Tyrone Davis, say, I reached a turning point in my life. Is there anybody here that's reached a turning point in your life? Is there anybody here? May God is able this morning. Is there anybody here? May God will make a way for you this morning. Is there anybody here? Know that you are willing this morning. For I heard the Bible say he giveth power to the faint. I heard him say he giveth to them that have no might. He increaseth strength. Even the youth shall faint and the weary and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. But the 31st verse, I begin to shout. It says, but they that wait. I got hung up on the day, but they that wait upon the Lord, not on the law, but upon the law. You got to know that the target of my action is in the law. I lean upon the law. I call on the law. I trust in the law. Is there anybody here that trusts in the law? I heard the Bible say, I will trust in the law. I heard my mother say, I trust in the law until I die. Is there anybody here willing to be a winner this morning? The Bible says, they that wait upon the law shall renew their strength, that shall mount up the wings of an eagle. In other words, the eagle flies high, but he looks down low. I want to be a high eagle this morning. I want to flap my wings like an eagle this morning. I want to run and not get weary. Why don't you lift your hands this morning? Tell the Lord, I'm a winner in the Lord's house. I'm a winner in God's house. Mentally, I'm a winner in the Lord's house. I'm emotionally in the Lord's house. I'm a winner in physical being. I'm a winner because I'm a family man. I'm a winner because I love the Lord. But most of all, I'm a winner because he died on Calvary for my sin. Is there anybody here know that Jesus died on Calvary? Is there anybody here know that he died? Didn't he die? He died, but Sunday morning he got up out of the grave with all power in his hand. He got up with all power in his hand. He got up with all power in his hand. There's hope in the midst. In the midst. There is hope in the midst of a pandemic. There's hope It ain't open yet. I don't care what it looked like. It's not open yet. We still got some faith. We still got some joy. I still have joy this morning. And all I've been through, I still got joy this morning. Do you have joy this morning? Do you have joy this morning? Ain't God able? Won't he do it? Do you know he'll do it? He'll do it. Do you love him this morning? If you heard the word this morning, and you have given up, you was down in the dumps, didn't have money in your pocket, didn't have food in your icebox, didn't have food in the pantry, but I'm here to tell you, the God I serve will make a way right now. He'll do it. He'll do it. And I know he'll do it. And the reason I know is because I'm a witness. I'm a witness. What God will do. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God, for what you've done in my life. God has spoken. Let me check. Say amen. Why don't you just for a moment, bow your head wherever you are. Wherever you are, bow your head now. If you're driving, bow it mentally. Close your eyes mentally. Tell the Lord, God, I thank you. Whatever situation, Paul said, whatever situation I'm in, Lord, I thank you. Do you thank him this morning? Do you thank him this morning? Do you thank him this morning? Do you really thank him this morning? I don't care what Susie said. I don't care what Diane said. I don't care what Mama said. I don't care what, but do you thank him this morning that he's brought you? He'll divide. Put money in the pocket when you didn't have. Won't he do it? He'll give you hope. God bless you. Join us next Sunday morning. I'm praying. Join us next Sunday. Next Sunday morning. Join us next Sunday morning at 10 o'clock. Don't forget we will be sharing right after the message, the Lord's Supper. You can pick it up on Saturday morning. Our deaconess will be in the parking lot. Ready to give you, ready to, you know, they have to get out the car, they'll bring it to you. Come by and pick it up. Right here at 321 South 10th Street in the heart of Temple, Texas. For God and the Holy Ghost is having a fit over here. Shouting is over here. Healing is over here. Praying is over here. Baptizing is over here. 321. South 10th Street. You can join us every Sunday morning. Send us a gift on the gift of five. You can write us P.O. Box 901, Temple, Texas 76503. If you want to give a gift to this ministry, to this church, amen. Amen. We are announcing on the air that you did get it. We did get it. Send it to give them five. Send it to P.O. Box 901, Temple, Texas 76503. God bless you, and we'll see you next Sunday morning.